Okay, so welcome everybody. Today, my name is Dirk Geveling, and today we're going to talk about building a multi-core apply function for pandas. But first, we have to talk about the problem. So a few months ago, I was writing some pandas code, some Python, and I used an apply function, and it turned out to be very, very slow. Now, part of the reason was because my code was, well, relatively shitty, if you will, but also I was using a very, very large data frame. So in that case, you can do multiple things, right? So you can try to factorize your code, which can sometimes be a little bit difficult, or you can basically use a different library, for example, Dask or Modin, or even Swifter, if you will. However, I thought, well, maybe I can actually do it myself, right? So I made it myself, well, quite difficult, if you will. So that turned out to be kind of a rabbit hole. So I ended up in the domain of actually memory management on the system, as well as how pandas structures it data frames. But the why is basically just because I wanted to look into it. So I am going to show you that road, and I hope that in the end, well, everybody learns a little bit from this. But before we are going to go into that, I first want to handle some basics. So whenever you start your computer and you start a program, basically a browser or your IDE, the OS will actually create a process. And the same happens when you start a Python process. So if you execute some Python code, you will actually a process will be started. Now, Python has something which is called multiprocessing. And with multiprocessing, one process can actually start multiple processes, like so. And on these multiple processes, you can actually distribute the amount of work, if you will, which basically means that you can execute code in parallel, which makes stuff a lot faster. Now, I do have to stress that this is different from multi-threading, because with multi-threading we still have something which is called the global interpreter lock, and this global in interpreter lock from which we have one process basically tells you that you can only execute one piece of code at a time. However, with multiprocessing, we don't have this problem because we have multiple processes, which means that we have multiple locks, which means that we can still process code in parallel. However, there's a problem with multiprocessing, or so we are led to believe. So the problem with multiple processing is that we can't actually share memory. So say I have a big pandas data frame in process one, then I can't really use it in process two or process three, simply because I cannot access it. So Python actually has a system for that in order to share objects. In the case I want to send or share an object with a different process, I will actually, or Python will actually send that object from one process to the to the other, and it does so by translating this object into a set of bytes. Then the other process will receive it. It will translate it back, and then it can use that object. This is basically called pickling, hence the crudely drawn pickle over there. So actually, if you use scikit-learn and you actually want to store a model, then you are doing exactly the same, since you call actually pickle dump, and then you store the model in a file which is basically just a byte, and later on you load it in again, and this is exactly the same, except now you just send the bytes to a different process. So now that we have the basics, what are we going to look at? Or actually, first, let's talk about the bad sides of pickling. So one of the problems is that pickling is rather slow, if you will. I mean, you have to do a lot of functionality in order to share this object, which is something you definitely don't want. And another problem is that you're actually making a copy per process. So if I have a data frame in my main process and I will send it to another process, I will actually be creating a copy and using double the amount of memory. And that of course scales linearly with all the processes that I'm going to use. So this is obviously not ideal, since if you have a very, very large data frame, then you will run out of memory really, really quickly. So what we are going to look at is we're first going to look at how pickling performs. Then we are going to look at can we do it better? And for that, we actually have to look into the pandas, how pandas stores this data in internally. And we're also going to look into, how can we actually write this into a format, if you will, that we can use it very simply with pandas. So first, a random piece of code where we actually just generate a large data frame. So we are generating a large data frame containing multiple columns of integer, as well as one column with floats in there. There is actually a specific reason for that, but we will come to that later. So what does the multiple processing code look like when we actually want to pickle? So what we do is we create a pool, which basically says, okay, we serve this many processes. Next, we generate that amount of data frames. So in the case of three workers, we will generate three random data frames. And then we call pool map. And pool map basically says, okay, I wanna execute this function and also give these three data frames as an argument. Then the three processes will start running, and once they are done, we can actually call pool close, which will wait until all the processes are done, and then the pool will be closed, and we basically finish with our program. So then I run this, and I got the following: out of memory error. So basically, you can do two things in this case. You can either buy a new computer with more memory, or you can actually just make a smaller data frame, which is what I did for this demo, if you will. So this worked quite well, but then I wanted to know, okay, so how much memory am I actually using? So there is a library in Python called the memory profiler, which you can actually use to track the memory. And so when you use that, it will actually register the amount of memory being used over the whole time for your whatever data or whatever Python program you are writing. And the plot looks something like this. So in this case, the first slanted line is the time where the system is actually initializing the data frame, or the multiple data frames, I should say. Then I put in a sleep, which basically means that this was basically just for demonstration purposes. But at that point, the multiprocessing starts. And then we can see that the system actually starts to pickle, and we see that in the end we use almost double the amount of memory than our data frame is actually, than the size of our data frame. At the end, we actually see that the memory dropping and that the memory is dropping again. But this basically means that we're just done with our program. So okay, this looks okay, and we finish in approximately 25 seconds, if you will, which is an okay score for the size of our data frame. However, I'm not really happy about the fact that we use double the memory, right? So then I started to play around a little bit, and I thought, okay, what if I just store my data frame in a global and then reference it from my process that I spawn to that global? So that looks as follows. So instead of just declaring the data frames, or instead of just initializing the data frames, I actually first initialize a global, then I store the data frames in there. Next, I call pool map, where we actually load the following function, where we reference back to that global, which is multi-df, right? So this function will actually be executed on the different processes. Now, this actually worked. I didn't get an error, which was really, really nice. However, when I looked at the memory profile, I saw something very weird, because I was now using almost 12 gigabytes instead of 6. And I was very, very surprised by this because my system actually only had 8 gigabytes of memory. So, yeah, what did happen? Did we maybe download RAM or anything? I had no idea. So when I looked at this and I compared it to the Piklin graph, I actually saw that, well, it's already a lot faster. So what we can see is that this global trick actually finished in approximately 15 seconds or even a little bit less, which is already really, really nice, right? So we got a speed gain, but somehow we are using 12 gigabytes of memory, even if we only have 8 gigabytes available. So what is happening here? Well, for this, I thought like, okay, well, maybe this memory profiler is actually just tracking a different type of memory. So I actually want to get the system memory. And I know that in US or in Unix and also OS X system, you have this command called free-m, which basically just displays the amount of memory that is being used. So I wrote a small Python program which would actually pull this command and which would actually get these numbers out of there. So I would actually requesting the amount of memory that was in use on the system outside of my Python process. The downside over here is that there will be some noise from the system itself because it's also using this memory. But generally, if you're not running anything next to it, you will not really notice that. So then I ran this again for the Piklin stuff, and this is the graph that came out. Now I should say that I started pulling this memory after I already initialized the data frame. So the stuff that we're seeing here is just at the start of the multiprocessing part. That's the reason why the slanted line is gone. So when we start the multiprocessing part, we are actually using, well, approximately 3 to 5 gigabytes, which is somewhat the same as we saw before. So then I did the same for the global trick. And this is what I got out. Well, you can directly see that you can't really pinpoint over here when the Piklin actually starts. But if you look at the y-axis, it only goes up to 4 MBs. And in fact, if you plot this over the previous plot, then we see that the global trick is actually not using any extra memory at all, which is even more crazy, right? So yeah, at this point, I was relatively flabbergasted, if you will. And I just wanted to find out, okay, so what is happening and what's going on here? And for that, we have to actually look a little bit into the OS and internal. So this is going to be the somewhat technical part of the talk that I'm giving. Okay. So basically, a memory, so actual physical memory, works the same as a Python array. Since you have a location where you store something, so for example, you store a string over there. Well, with memory, it works exactly the same, but in this case, you have a memory address where you store a byte, and this byte contains a value. So we also have a second part within our system, which is called the page table. And the page table sits in between the CPU and the actual physical memory, so the RAM memory on my PC. And the page table kind of works like an intermediary. And the way that works is, say a Python process boots up, it starts, then it actually starts to request memory because it wants to store stuff, right? And it actually asks to the page table, hey, can I maybe get some memory? And the page table says, yeah, sure, here you have a list of addresses, and you can store whatever memory you want in there. But what the page table actually does not tell the Python process that these are not the actual physical memory addresses. In fact, the page table actually tries to find within the physical memory where it can store these addresses, if you will, or where it can find a place to actually store the data that the Python process wants to use. So what you get is, or what the page table actually does is, it makes a mapping from the memory addresses that it gave to the to the Python process, to the memory addresses that it, well, and to the physical memory addresses. So that looks something like this. So in this case, you have a page table, you have the virtual memory addresses, which are for the Python process, and you have the physical memory addresses, which are actually the RAM memory, if you will. Now, I should say that this, that these aren't actual memory addresses, these are called pages, and a page can just be seen as a block of memory, if you will. Now, what the page table also tells you is whether you can read or write to a certain memory address. So in this case, the Python process can actually read from a virtual memory address 2, or page, I should say, and it can actually write to physical memory 18, for example. Now, this is all nice, and probably you are questioning why the hell are you telling me this? Well, it's because there's a very specific function executed within Python if you call pool.map. And that function is called osfork. And what osfork basically does is, instead of just spawning a totally new process, it says, okay, so I have this main process, and from this, I spawn a new process, which is what osfork does, but I actually inherit the state of my main process. And for the page table, that looks like this. So you have a parent process, and once we call osfork, the child process will actually get the page table. But there is one small difference, which is that the page table that the child process gets only has read flags on basically all the memory addresses, or basically on all the pages. Now, of course, this is very useful, but what if the child process actually wants to write to that memory? Well, at that point, the system actually recognizes, okay, so the child process wants to write to virtual page address 9. Let me copy that page for you and store it in the physical memory. So that basically means that what is ever in physical memory or physical page 27 will actually get copied, and then the child process can write to it because it will have its own page. This is called copy on write memory. So whenever the child process wants to change something, that page is actually being copied. So, well, this is nice, right? Because this basically means that if we spawn a new process and we have in the parent process we have a big data frame, we can actually access this from the child process. However, there is one big thing or one big problem with Python with using this system. So, can anybody maybe tell me why? No? No? Okay. Okay. So basically, probably you have heard of the saying in Python, everything is an object. So when we have, for example, C, so a compiled language, when we have the number 42, it is actually just being stored in whatever memory. However, in Python actually creates an object out of that digit and actually places some metadata next to it. In this case, it often stores the type of the digit for example an integer, as well as something else, which is called the reference counter. And whenever you access anything in Python, for example an object, this reference counter will be increased. And that is actually a problem because the reference counter is very close to the data, in this case a digit 42. So that would mean that if Python wants to increase this reference counter, it wants to actually write to this page table, which means that this page table will be copied because of copy on write memory. So copy on write memory is basically useless for Python, because whenever we want to access an object, we actually have to copy it because we want to increase the reference counter. However, it did work for pandas, right? So why is that? Well, actually, now basically, so every object will be copied. So, but for pandas, it did work. So why was that? So for that, we have to go a little bit into the pandas internals. So say we just have a standard data frame, a very simple one with three columns with strings, one column with integers, and one column with a bool. Pandas has something which is called the block manager, where basically when it stores a data frame, it actually stores all the same columns of the same type together. This is called a block. So in this case, the strings are being stored together in one block. The integers are being stored together in one block, as well as the booleans. Now, why does this help us? Well, the main reason for that is because these blocks are actually stored as NumPy arrays. And NumPy arrays are actually really, really interesting. Because what NumPy arrays do is, they store the data as just, approximately an C array, which basically means that it doesn't have any of that crap about reference counters or whatever. And then you have an object, which is called the NumPy array object, which actually references to the data. So whenever we want to access this NumPy array, we will only increase one reference counter, which is only on one page, if you will. And the rest of the data, we can just access without messing with the reference counters. So that's very, very nice, because then we will only copy one page. And this is the key to it. It's because the reason that we can actually access this memory without copying it is because, very simply, we just don't use reference counters over here in NumPy arrays. So that basically means victory wide, we're there. Well, not really. I mean, because we still have to add this to pandas, right? We still want to use this trick to actually write a decent apply function. So one way we can do that, so building a multi-core apply for, in this case, only row operations, we can actually use something which is called pandas extensions. And with the pandas extensions, you actually register an accessor, if you will, which is just a class. In this case, I named it Coply, multi-core apply, Coply somewhere in there, or not. And what you can do is you can basically register any custom function that you have to a data frame. Now, say we write this accessor, we put all our memory trick code in there, spawning the multiple processes, doing the pandas apply in those processes. How would we use this Coply accessor? Well, it's actually very, very easy, because once we've loaded it in, we can actually just do dataframe.coply.apply, and it works exactly the same, but now you have multiprocessing for apply without actually copying the memory. So this works actually very, very easy, and I thought that this was a nice function in pandas. So how does it perform? Well, on the x-axis over here, we have the number of cores, and for one core, which is basically just single-threaded, it runs in about 160 seconds. So that's relatively slow, but when we use 8 cores, we actually see that, well, it finishes in approximately 35 seconds. So that's a nice gain, and we are also not using any extra memory, right? So then the next question should be, is this useful? Well, not really. I mean, there are already so many better and better frameworks to do this. Again, Dask or even Spark would be 10 times better than the stuff that I've just written, basically. However, there are a few learnings to take from this. So one learning is actually that, yes, we can share large data frames between multiple processes. So whenever you want to do something with multiple processing, think of this trick, because it is actually possible if you only want to read from that data. So basically saying that with multiprocessing you can't share memory, that's just a lie. Now, I should say that OS fork only works for the superior operating systems, which is basically Unix and also OS X, but not Windows. So for the Windows fanboys over here, I am sorry, this doesn't work. But there are probably not that many, are there? Maybe, I don't know. So, and then the second learning is that, well, the memory profiler actually doesn't show you the actual memory, but just the virtual memory. Right, so you have to take that into consideration when actually profiling your program, because you could be using a lot less memory. And then, of course, pandas extensions are actually very, very easy to use. I would recommend them if you want to extend pandas in a very, very clean way. and also a very easy way to use your extensions. So yeah, basically on that, I hope that you learned a little bit about this, about the memory management and stuff. And yeah, basically, thank you for your time.